Very good evening. I am Shiva and I welcome you all to the NCERT special in collaboration with National Institute of Educational Planning and Administration. Today's topic of discussion is capturing the most significant change in schools. And to discuss this topic, in our studio we have Dr. N. Maithili, an assistant professor at National Center for School Leadership, NEPA. I welcome you, Dr. Maithili.
Thank you.
Dr. Maithili, when we just talk about the school change, we have several programmatic interventions.
Yes.
Like SSA, RMSA and recently Samagra Siksha. But still we do not have much evidence of school, the process of school improvement. So how basically to capture the process of a school improvement or let's say change?
Okay. That's a very nice and a very important question that you asked. And here, as we know that in the programmatic interventions, we also evaluate and monitor the programmatic interventions. However, all these traditional approaches of, monitoring and evaluation are basically well-defined indicators, which actually lose out to a certain extent the processes that go into how schools change, how schools improve. Okay. So, in order to overcome this, we have another tool which actually looks at the qualitative changes that happen in the schools while implementing the programs. We have been implementing for the last 3 decades, and so this technique which are psychosocial, qualitative level. Processes.
So that's interesting, I think, to know about this technique. So what's the key feature of most significant change?
Okay. So as I said, this monitoring and evaluation techniques are predefined, whereas in the most significant change, there are no predefined indicators. A change to be captured in the first 2 hours now here. And stories are collected from mostly those involved in the change processes and participants. Monitoring and evaluation techniques, this changes are captured in terms of numbers, say like a coverage, how many schools are covered, how many people are covered, and etc. And the stories, most significant change story collects the stories, the monitoring and evaluation just looks at the impact and the causality of a few factors. And therefore, it is a third interventions are studied. And here, whereas it is participatory, the people who are making the change also participate in evaluating. And
you're just using this.
That's very good. Yes. What is a story? A story is a very, very loaded term. It is not a story. Story of real change that is happening on the ground, and that is what it is described and described, narrated, felt, experienced, evidenced, and that is the story here. And hence it is called a significant story, and therefore it is not a fictitious story or a make-believe story or a dream story.
So as in your slide, the stories are collected. So how to basically collect stories, particularly let's say in the school?
Okay. Yeah. See, how do we really collect? And here, for the sake of our understanding and to use, I have divided it into 4 stages.
Okay.
And one is called the preparation for collecting significant stories, collection of significant stories from the field, identification of more significant story, documentation of most significant change stories. Here I am using MSE.
So after every stage or any planning comes the execution.
Yes.
How
preparatory stage, preparation stage. And this this, I will take it up with the example of the school leadership development program that is happening right now since, 2012. So, how do we capture this change? Through the programmatic mode, there are changes happening. There are, schools that are getting improved. And how do we capture it? So, using the most significant change technique. And here, we constitute two panels. One is at the state panel, which is school panel, which is called the school level panel, because with that actually the change is happening, and therefore the changes have to be captured at the school in the programmatic conventions. Significantly, in the entire state, will be an expert panel. Okay, and who constitutes the members of this panel? Are the state coordinator from NCSL, that is the National Center School Leadership, which is actually implementing the program from the national level, and state resource group facilitators trained in the coordinator who is involved with the SLDP, representatives from the school leadership academies that have been set up in the last 2 years across all the states, and representation from the Department of Education, which is involved through and through this program from RMSA times to the now Samagra Shiksha, and the NGOs who are working in this field of school leadership. When it comes to state level panels, then 10% of the total teachers in the school would be the three school management committee members, then 10 students from each class, because they are the stakeholders, and who are the people who have to experience the change and beneficiaries of the change. Then 5 other community members or local leaders who are interested in the school education in that vicinity, cluster resource coordinators, and 1 member from the state expert panel who would connect between school, state level and the national level.
So, the two panels, state level and the school level.
District level is not actually required when it comes to smaller states and UTs, because they are smaller in size, number of schools. But when it comes to big states, it may be required. Like UP, Bihar, Madhya Pradesh, Rajasthan, they are all very big states. Some of the districts in states might constitute a smaller state elsewhere. So, in that case, we can have even the district level panel of the state level expert committees, but they may not constitute the expert committee, but the panel can be constituted on those lines.
So, at the preparatory stage, you just told us about the state level and the school level. So, when we just come to these two panels, what's it?
So, we take of them now. When I am talking about level expert panel, I am also referring to the district level, since you have raised that question. Now, this state level expert panel takes the lead to collect the significant stories, then develop simple and flexible formats to collect the change stories from district and school panels, then guide, support the district and school panel members in collecting the stories, then discusses the direction of collecting stories with these panels also, and it discusses and changes the direction, therefore sets right and takes collecting actually the change stories that are happening on the field. Similarly, when it comes to the role of the school panel, what do they do? And here, members of the panel will actively engage in collecting the school change stories. They conduct weekly meetings to review the progress of collection and direction of the collecting of the stories. Then they review the themes on which the change stories are collected, identify the gap, and adjust the direction of the collecting of stories too. Have another bigger role. They organize meetings to discuss the change stories to be considered significant enough. This is extremely important. Chain stories are collected, and chain stories have been heard, evidenced or seen, observed, but which of them are significant? That is something. Therefore, one need to organize in the school amongst the panel members to really thrash out which is a significant one, which we need to really zero down on, and right. Probe every, therefore you probe every story deeply to know all the details and eliminate fictions. That's very, very important, and identify at least three significant chain stories, and systematically document these chain stories and share with the state expert panel up.
Okay, so this is just coming in my mind. Huh. After the formation of panel and understanding the role of these panel, so these panel might engage in collecting the most significant chain stories. So is it true? Or if they do, then how they actually do it?
Yes, obviously they have to do, because they have been in the participatory technique. They are engaged right from the beginning of implementing the stories, implementing the changes, to really evolve the technique of collecting the changes, and now obviously they have to collect the changes, significant change stories. Okay, so this stage is called the second stage of getting into the process of most significant change story. So therefore, what do? They develop indicative set of questions to identify the significant change stories and collect as many significant stories as possible from a range of stakeholders and change agents who are involved in making the changes. And how do they do it? There are some set of indicative questions that I am presenting here. These are only indicative and not rigid. People might can form many more sets of questions, but these only give the directions. And what are they? What was the reason for initiating the school change? Why did the reason arise in the first place? And what was the plan of action that was designed? How did you go about implementing the school change? Whom did you involve? And what did she or he do? And where did the change take place? Because why am I saying this? Where did the change take place? Because we are implementing the change in the school, but its ripple effects can be felt even outside the school, maybe in the community, maybe in the house, maybe amongst the other members in the community or a larger society. We don't know. So where did the change happen? That needs to be captured, the locale of the change. And when did you observe the change first? Extremely important. There should not be a lapse of time, and therefore it is important. How long did change take place? Because is it flimsy or is it fair enough time that I have been observing the change, and therefore it can be called as a significant change.
Okay.
And that's very, very important.
Okay.
Yeah.
Several people have the several perspective. Hence the stories could be several.
Exactly.
So isn't it confusing?
Huh.
And basically, how to identify the story is actually most significant change story.
Yes, this takes us to the stage three.
Okay.
So a change story of one place need not necessarily be a change story of the other place.
Huh.
That is what you mean. So therefore, how significant is it?
Right.
That is the first question. The second question is, if it is significant, how significant enough is it to say that it is the most significant?
Right.
That's exactly the question, isn't it? And therefore, this third stage is very, very critical, and that is called identify the most significant change. Now, here the role of the school state level expert comes. Okay, and what do they do? First, they collect all the chain stories which were identified as significant chain stories at the school level. There may be some 400, 500 chain stories that have come, maybe 1000, doesn't matter. But all the chain stories are to be taken and review the stories.
Mm-hmm.
And how do they review? And there is a specific process that has been laid down in this technique.
Mm-hmm.
That is, one of the member will read aloud the stories, the others listen carefully and make their own observations. Okay, then members, after listening, they raise questions and discuss and clarify the glaring gaps that arise. Okay, then screen and select those studies which are worthy to be studied for identifying whether it is a most significant change or not.
Right.
What do they do? In the next step, after reviewing, there is analysis that takes place about the content and authenticity of the story that has been narrated or presented. And that is, narrative analysis is how frequently the change has occurred, whether the changes have sustained for at least 6 months, and is it one time change, whether the changes are significant enough, etc. This is what is considered. Now, in the third step, it is about filtering the stories. Mm-hmm. And at least 70% of the intervened schools must reflect these significant changes.
Mm-hmm.
Okay?
Okay,
but because the changes are happening, now we are looking at a macro picture. We are looking at such a macro picture that the entire state has to be covered through the implementation of the mega program such as school leadership development in the state.
Mm-hmm.
Now, when we are looking at it, a few schools happening, in a few schools if a change happens, is that enough? No.
Okay.
So, if whether the 70% of the intervened schools witness these changes, that's very, very critical. And therefore, in the third step of the analysis, identifying the most significant change, the filtering of the stories come.
Okay.
Okay. So, here at least therefore 70% of the intervened schools must reflect significant changes.
Mm-hmm.
And when we are filtering like this, when we are studying in depth using the narrative analysis which I pointed out,
mm-hmm.
Adjust the direction of the filtering process. When you are filtering, we should not lose out on the very important and very subtle aspects of the change, and therefore one has to be very conscious in filtering these things. And therefore, a deliberation amongst the members of the panel to sit and deliberate, to sit and analyze, to sit and deeply reflect individually and collectively becomes a very, very crucial factor. Here, there are no set rules. Please note, this is a qualitative analysis of the stories, change stories, significant change stories that we are studying, and therefore, it is extremely important to deeply reflect on the stories.
Mm-hmm.
It is extremely important to really look at all these things, okay, and hence adjusting the direction of the filtering process while studying the stories is a crucial step.
Okay,
okay? Then not only this, what we should do is, we have studied, we have analyzed, we have authenticated sitting in the room. At the state level, it needs a physical check, a physical verification. So, we need to go back to the field, examine the strength of the evidences in the field, whether it is worthy enough to be called a most significant change.
Okay.
Okay. So, from there, after visiting, after doing a physical check, examine all the analysis, content analysis, authenticity that you have done back in your school,
mm-hmm.
back in the state level in the rooms, and now provide at least five robust reasons as to why the story can be called a most significant story for the state.
Okay.
See, when the process is so rigorous, when the process is so robust, and everyone is involved from the school level, the district level, the state level in filtering, in analyzing, in checking the stories, and you cannot find a large number of stories to be called most significant story.
Mm-hmm. Right.
This is exactly the crux of a qualitative analysis, a qualitative monitoring of the very subtle processes that go into the school change, the school improvement that is happening through an intervention, through a program or through a school head who himself or herself is initiating the change, or through a district officer, a block education officer who is intervening at his or her own level, right, or the state policy which has deliberated upon to bring about certain changes.
Right.
Look at the strength of it, and therefore not about many changes that you can come down to as most significant changes. It may be just 2 or 3 or at the most 5 most significant changes for the school. And hence, now look at it, we collected the change stories at the school level. When you look at it from the helm of the affair, that is the state level, you look at it at the school level as change stories collected, which schools can to be passed on to the state level. Then the state level experts or district level experts, intermediary studied and articulated to be significant enough to be further studied. So there is a funneling effect, and now from there the significant change stories, we are now getting into most significant change stories, and that is how the most significant change story can be generated, which is an alternative approach to the traditional approach of monitoring and evaluating, which is based on predefined indicators, and a third party evaluation which is not involved in the change processes or in the programmatic intervention, and therefore there may be a loss of information, therefore there may be a loss of capturing of the processes, or maybe a loss of capturing the data, which is what is attempted to be overcome in the most significant change studies, and a technique which is alternative to the or which is a substitute to the monitoring and evaluation techniques. So this is how we arrive at most significant changes that may happen, that can happen, or that can be identified through the interventions whosoever does at whatever level, be it at the from the national level, be it at the state level, be it at the school level, or at all levels.
So
that's the way.
What I'm thinking, during this process, a whole lot of documents will be collected in.
Yes.
So something, if you could just highlight on that.
Oh, yes. See, this is the most important phase, because we know that we are very excited to do a lot of work, a lot of action-packed work. We want to witness it. We want to experience it. We want to visualize it. We want to be the change makers. We want to be the leaders of change. However, in the process, we forget the documentation. If we are forgetting the documentation, then after some time, memory is lost. The institutional memory is also lost. Not only that, the memory of the nation's reform processes is lost. This is exactly what to be overcome, and that is where the stage 4 comes, and that's called the documentation of most significant change stories.
Okay.
How do we do that? And here, what we can do is categorize the most significant changes that we have collected now under different domains.
Okay.
Okay. What are these domains? Now, since we program as an example, we also have a school leadership curriculum developed for implementing this program. There are 7 key areas, and so these 7 key areas can be used as larger domains. Within these larger domains, there are many themes, many subunits. Within the subunits, there are themes, and so according to the state's context, we can define these domains, and also we can systematically identify the themes within these each domains and organize the most significant stories across these domains.
Okay.
Maybe that one domain might not get any significant change story, but the other domain may get more than 3 or 4. When you collate at a national level, when you collate at a state level, you might get. Mm-hmm. But that doesn't matter. We need not have to fit into the pigeonholes of the key areas as domains just because there are domains. We must recognize where has the change taken place, how has the change taken place, what is the effect of that most significant change that has influenced the reform process through the leadership program,
right,
through the leadership interventions, or through the leaders who have brought about the change. This is exactly what we need to do.
Right.
And so therefore, now after having done, the stories have been created from the school level, teachers, HMs, students, SMC members, everybody has come together to create the story. Okay. Now, then at the district level, the stories have been created for the district. At the state level, once again, these stories have been again re-examined and recreated.
Mm-hmm.
And there is a process of recreation and a co-creation that has happened,
okay,
you know, while documenting the stories already. And when we need to do of these stories, important, you know, the oral and written, you know, renderings have to, the oral documents have to, the Facebook, nowadays, school, everyone, social media, whatever, use the social media, that has to come. In this way, when it is a synergy, you know, together, briefing most significant change to stories that have also been documented. Just because they are not most significant change stories, don't let them go away.
Okay.
Don't let them leave. They have made at micro levels for a small length of time, and they are important, but may it is important to document and use it for some purpose to improve the very reform processes, mm-hmm, and therefore it is also important to document these significant change stories also in the same manner that we have documented most gap may be identified. This is what very helpful. Now, do we stop at this? No. We need to really disseminate the information through conferences, through presentations on various platforms, at the school level, at the cluster level, at the school complex level, at the block level, at the district level, because it is a story that needs to inform all the school heads.
Mm-hmm.
Heads, all the teachers, all the block resource and cluster resource coordinators to, you know, really use them to bring about improvement in the system,
mm-hmm,
through leadership programs and through many other programs. And not to forget the primary unit of change, and that is the school. Share with the schools systematically. Go to the school, share with it.
Mm-hmm.
Be in touch with the school to continue the reform process. In this way, the most significant change technique can be effectively used to capture the changes that are happening, the improvements that are happening, the changes that are not happening,
mm-hmm,
the improvements that may not be up to the mark. And all these insights can be, you know, captured with these most significant change techniques, which is what, you know, really informs us for our, you know, programs, for our school change processes,
mm-hmm,
to improve the schools, school qualities, as well as what we are witnessing today, the not so pleasant story, and that is students are not learning, you know, up to the mark. Their levels of learning has been lower than the minimum level. In order to bring about this you know, the change, especially the primary stakeholder of the entire education system, that is the child. You know, child is the primary beneficiary, and child has to be benefited. If that is the case, these most significant change stories will throw subtle insights on the psychosocial environment, psychosocial, you know, insights of, you know, what has gone wrong, what has, you know, what has went well in the system, and therefore bridge the gaps. It is so important, and therefore maybe in a way we can use this as an assessment technique too when it comes to, you know, using this most significant change you know, method. However, assessment is completely different, but it may be used in a way slightly using the spirit of this. May use or we may not use, we can drop it too, but then it has to inform the child's learning. That is what is extremely important and the need of the hour today.
Right.
Yeah.
So, ma'am, your concluding words now?
My concluding words for this is that most significant change stories can be adopted by anyone, be it a school head, be it a cluster resource person, be it a block resource person, be it the system level functionaries at the state, the national level or the district level. Anybody can use it, and even the very departments and various governments at all levels, from the national to the school level, can use this and make the best use of it to continue the reform process in a positive way to improve the student learnings in the country.
Right. Thank you so much, ma'am. So, today we very well understood about how to capture the most significant change in schools for the betterment of the school. And for all this information, thank you again, ma'am.
Thank you.
Further, if you have any query or any suggestion regarding any program, then you can dial into our toll-free number or can drop an email to us. Moreover, you can send your question along with your selfie or video selfie on our WhatsApp number, and the number is 8076754446. Which is flashing on your screen. And with this, I am Shilpa signing off. Till then, take care and keep watching Kishore Manch.